Hello and welcome to TG2 Cars and Stripes, a new car show where two British blokes, that's me and him, drive a load of American cars in America. And in this episode, we've got hold of the two biggest, baddest Ford trucks that money can buy.
And then I get to up the ante in another big, bad Ford truck.
Yeah.
There's nothing like variety, but America is all about the great outdoors, and we've decided to travel through it as fast as possible in the jumpiest, sidewaysest, most outrageous way possible.
Don't worry, those are definitely words. Take a look at this. One word, wheel arches. Or is that two words? I think it might be two words. Either way, if you want something to play around in the dirt with that's tough, that's powerful, that looks a little bit like a mini monster truck, this is what you want. The new Ford Bronco Raptor, or Braptor, if you're a bit short on time. It's got a 3-litre twin-turbo V6, just over 400 horsepower, 37-inch off-road tyres, 50% stiffer chassis, and all for $85,000. Hang on a minute, can you hear that? Pretty low-key entrance.
Hello, I like that. I'm pretty sure my kiddie's got a Barbie one of those.
Yeah, all right. Don't rub it in yet. This does look like I might have been outgunned.
Yeah, so the Raptor you really want is the F-150 Raptor R. $109,000 worth of trophy truck goodness for the road and for out here.
Engine?
V8, of course. What have you got in this?
Engine for the Ford GT supercar. V6.
Oh, the little V6 that they did for economy. Well, this also has an engine from another car, and it's only a Mustang, but it is a 5.2-litre supercharged V8 with 700 horsepower.
Yeah, I'm clearly not going to win a game of Top Trumps, am I? But we're here. We've got, 186,000 acres to play with in Johnson Valley, which should be enough.
Yeah.
Let's face it. And can you do me a favour? I've never in my life done a jump. My inner child would like to learn how to do a jump.
What do you do at Top Gear all day long?
I don't know, sit around in the office, writing, working.
Oh, Jethro. Working, yeah, I remember that. Yeah, we can do a jump. There's millions around here. I think it could be... It's any direction. Just follow me. We'll find a jump.
All right, I'll try and keep up. Go easy on me,
just
right?
A fourth gear, like 110 mile an hour one, yeah?
Yeah, yeah. Entry level.
There's Jack.
Oh, there he is. He's miles ahead. Let's see if I can chase him down.
Oh. I'm just in the dust.
Oh, I can't see where I'm going. Literally no idea where I'm going.
Woohoo! It's incredible to think this is lean, isn't it?
Right. This Bronco Raptor, what can I tell you? Well, first of all, I'm in a dust cloud from Jethro. Come on. Look, we need to talk about this engine. It's good, don't get me wrong. It can properly shimmy out here. It's plenty of power on this surface, but it's just lacking a bit in character. And I think I'm being spoiled by the fact that F-150 Raptor R, the engine in that thing, is an absolute maniac. This car is brilliant, but it needs a V8.
I have been very lucky to drive Raptors in the past, and the only thing that would disappoint you about the old car is the engine, the V6. Well, now I have a real engine. It's called the Predator. Listen to it. Okay, little jump coming up. Let's see if we can get some air. Oh, this is a good one.
feel a little bit cheap, but who cares when a car looks this cool from the outside? And honestly, right now, I'm reassured by the fact that they've spent the money on the things that matter, the suspension, the wheels, the stuff that's going to keep us out of trouble out here.
The suspension is just magic. Stuff that you would imagine that you'd have to drive over it. 30 miles an hour, you can do, well, I'm doing 60 now, not even worried. Probably do close to the top speed of 114 down the way. Look at it, unbelievable.
There you are. Can't do this in Surrey. How you getting on there? You seem to have pulled out a bit of a lead on me.
Yeah, it's angry. I think that is the only way to describe this truck. It's such an angry engine, and it's everything. Before, the Raptor felt like a really wild thing with a relatively tame engine. Speaking of which, you're driving a very similar engine now. But now it feels all together just pure lunacy.
Do you know what? When we hit all the bumps, I reckon we're having just as much fun because we've pretty much got the same suspension and wheels and setup underneath us. I'm actually a bit of a lightweight compared to you, as he hits a massive bump, but you've actually got the noise, you've got the anger, you're definitely having more of a laugh. When you drive past me, come on, drive past me here, listen to this.
Fully lit. I have to say, your truck looks mega, and the way the suspension works when you're in close proximity is very cool. I am convinced that you're not having quite as much fun as me. However, there is a way for you to have more fun than me, and that is for us to go and find this jump.
I like the thinking. I've kind of been putting it off. I'm a bit nervous if I'm on this, Jethro. I don't mind hooning around like this on ground level, but being airborne. I mean, this thing weighs, what, 2.5 tons? Yours must be even more.
Wrong word there, Jack. You said yours.
And this is the great beauty of our life. These are not our trucks. So put aside your fears and embrace the chaos. Let's go find the jump.
Business. Is this the one?
Yeah. Maybe not this direction because the road drops away, but this is nice because coming from low, nice little kicker. It's nice and narrow for jeopardy.
Which you actually want it to be narrow.
You want a little bit of jeopardy, I think. Yeah, I would say we've driven around a lot and this is the best thing I've seen. So this is where it happens.
Okay, right, here's the plan, because you're the expert, you're gonna go first.
Okay.
Agreed?
Yeah.
And if the front end of your car falls off, I'll just head back to the hotel.
Okay, but I'll come with you, obviously. Have you got any matches? We can burn this one if it breaks. Okay, I think I'm ready, so let me know when's good and I will come through, Jack. Just tell me there's no trophy trucks coming towards me at 120 mile an hour.
We are clear for trophy trucks. When you're ready, let's see how it's done.
Okay, here we go.
That was a big boy.
That, my friends, is proper. That was actually more fun than I anticipated.
Flipping hell. Very nice. Terrifying.
That felt good.
It
had like a recoil and everything, didn't it? It had a big bounce.
When you bounced?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was ace.
Right, go on then.
You're gonna have a great time.
It's gonna be my turn, isn't it? I'll be honest. I'm a bit anxious.
keep your foot on the throttle when you take off, because if you brake before, obviously you'll nosedive. So, so if you want to scrub a bit of speed, brake early, but then accelerate into the turn.
I hear. And what sort of speed do I want to be hitting that at?
It's hard to look, because you look and you're like, I would say 60-ish.
Yeah.
I wouldn't go much more than 60. For your first go, but yeah, enjoy it. It's mega. I'm gonna video you now.
Right.
I must try to remember this was my idea in the first place. Not gonna lie. Little bit cacking myself. Driving a straight line. I could do that. How are you feeling right now? This is a big moment.
I've just basically delivered my will in verbal form to this camera.
I think we need to mark this place as well. It's like losing your virginity all over again. So let's try it. Remember, keep the throttle open as you go over to keep it nice and flat.
All right, I got this.
Okay, go, 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 go.
That was terrifying. It looks like you're driving into a vertical wall at whatever I was doing. I think it was 55 I managed to hit. I'm getting thumbs up and waves from the cameraman, so that is always a good sign. Right, let's get the window down so Jeff has to say. Like a proud father.
How do you feel?
Like,
that was pretty good. What speed were you doing?
Well, over 50 and then hit the throttle at the bottom of the hill.
Yeah.
So probably 55 plus when I hit it.
It looked high and decent, and then it did a bounce. It, like, you definitely got air, and then it came down, and then you got the front. You're in one piece.
I'm absolutely buzzing, mate. That is, can I just say, you've been such a good sport showing me the way of the jump that we've sorted out something a bit special for you.
Oh, really?
Something a bit more senior.
Okay, that sounds good. Do you want one more go?
Okay, yeah, go on.
Yeah, go on. Go on. Jack, very impressed. Good effort. That was a mighty jump.
I learned from the maestro. Did you see the front end of that Bronco when it landed? It was just wobbling all over the shop. Yeah, it was full on. You got some good air in the F-150 though, didn't you?
I did. I loved the bounce. The recoil was
great.
The
recoil. And there was some sort of pre-game jumps, some recce jumps, we'll call them, where the landing didn't go quite as well as that one. I think we got a still that we could probably drop in right now where you basically landed on the front grille.
Well, I had to find the ramp. So I wanted you to have your first experience to be glorious. So I tested a few other obstacles, and that one, Jeff, definitely did not work out.
Yeah, good guinea pigging. So this car here, so this is as cool, this is as badass as Raptor gets in the UK. This is the Ranger Raptor. I was kind of prepped to sort of take the Mickey out of it a bit for being small and, you know, but it's actually really cool. It used to have a 2-litre diesel. That was hilarious. Now it's a proper petrol V6. Basically the same engine as the Ford GT.
I have heard that before. No, yeah. I actually think they've done a great job with this. The F-150 is awesome, but it's too big for us. And this, I want one actually. I'd have one of these for 6 months, easy.
How much?
60 odd grand.
Everything's 60 grand these days, isn't it? Now, at the end of that film, we mentioned that you had a special treat going on.
Yes.
Should we show them what it was?
Oh yeah, please.
Let's have a look.
This is the Ford Bronco DR, a factory-built off-road racer built to tackle the Baja 1000 and fly across the endless American landscape as if it's not really there at all. With a comically angry V8 soundtrack, of course. The DR, or Desert Racer, costs from $295,000, and just 50 will be built by Ford's partner for this project, Multimatic. The guys who also built the Ford GT supercar and its racing counterpart. Oh, and the Aston Martin Valkyrie. You know the Baja, right? The wild 1,000-mile race held in Mexico where spectators lay booby traps to catch out competitors, and those brutal yet almost balletic $1 million trophy trucks with 1,000 horsepower V8s float across the desert floor and fly over yumps that would snap a WRC car in two. Well, the DR Racer isn't quite in that class. Think of it as a turnkey privateer car with wicked performance, but not requiring superhuman abilities to drive. A kind of GT3 car for the desert. Today, we're going to experience it at the vast Johnson Valley Off-Highway Vehicle Recreation Site, and want to sample every type of territory that makes up a typical off-road rally. A flat-out dry lake bed, the rapid-fire bumps known as whoops, lower speed rock crawling, and of course, big, glorious jumps. My guide for the day is Wayne Israelson. Wayne has won the Baja 1000, has vast experience, and also sat with Jensen Button as he prepared to race at Baja. Now he gets me, no pressure.
Wayne, I feel like you need a catchphrase for this video. Have you got anything for me?
Let her eat.
So the first thing to say is that it's obviously not crazy quick. We got something over 400 horsepower, but 2.7, 2.8 tons. Having said that, we're up to 100, 103, there we go, 105. Found the limiter. Seven speeds, but I'm hitting 105 in six. And it deals with the high-speed lake bed as easily as you'd expect.
So we've reached 105 miles an hour on the smooth, dry lake bed, but this thing really comes to life when things get gnarly. Bring on the whoops.
So this is what Wayne's talking about, these sine waves that have been cut into the desert roads. Your men are just float along the top of them, having a steady throttle. But whatever way you do, it looks really cool, just like that. Okay, my turn.
So we're just getting into them now. You tell me the speed, and off we go.
Stay right. Sandwhoops, just roll through. Steady throttle. Very good. Steady throttle. Very good. Good job. Okay, now accelerate.
Accelerate, if you're sure.
Yeah, come on, let's go.
Woohoo! Wow. It soaks them up, but you really have to be on your, have your wits about you. And then you get this paddle. Brake pad knockoff, so the brake pedal goes away from you. So Wayne, how many miles does that happen for on the 1000?
Probably close to half of it.
So for 500 miles, you're dealing with that?
Yep, and depending on what class of vehicle you're in, you could be riding about like that or going three times as fast and not even feeling them.
Wow. I would pee my pants in about 25 minutes, I reckon.
Yeah, but you're wearing a catheter, so you just pee your pants, it's all good.
Now, we're going to try the third element, which is rocks, big rocks. Now, I'm not looking forward to this because it's slower, which sucks, but in a race, it's so important because slower means you're in those sections for a long time. And if you get a puncture, it's not game over. But let's say it takes you 10 minutes to change a wheel. You try catching that up across the desert, it takes a lot of time and a lot of speed. So this is crucial. I'm here for the Baja experience.
So this is the slow technical stuff. Is there much of this in off-road racing?
So there's a good deal. I mean, maybe 10%, but it is one of the areas where you, if you know how to do it, you can make up a lot of time.
Okay, so what's the magic formula?
Well, flow like water uphill. It's really that. It's really momentum and take the easiest line and don't get hung up on your diffs and keep your tires on the rocks rather than down in the middle so you don't get hung up. But really, it's just you just got to have this fluid momentum, this flow through the rocks.
It's knowing when to go slow as much as knowing when to go fast in this stuff.
Well, it's rarely the fastest car that wins the race. It's always the car that crosses the finish line first.
Yeah.
So if you drive too hard, you brake. So you have to know when to not do dumb stuff.
So this isn't considered that extreme, I guess.
This wouldn't be a rock section, but for a desert race, it would be a rocky section. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, I think this sort of stuff would get tiresome after a short period, yeah?
Yeah, it beats you up, and it's a good place to lose tires, hit a rock too hard, cut a tire, have to get out and change it, that kind of thing.
How much crew can you have on these races?
Much
How does
as
that
you can
work?
Afford.
Oh, really?
Yep.
So you have constant comms with your guys?
No, you can't really get that close. You have places where you cross roads where they can get a visual on you. You got places where you get near a road that are comms, radio comms, you're going slightly right here.
And then you have pre-designated fuel stops as well?
Well, you always designate your own in Mexico.
Yeah.
But yeah, you know where you're going to stop because the fuel's got to be there before you get there.
So in King of the Hammers, you're driving through stuff like this at this real speed.
I mean, you're not going 100 here. You're going fast enough to control the vehicle. But yes, you're still racing here. You're doing 35 miles an hour.
Wow.
You know, slowing down for this rock here so you don't hit that one, cut a tire, and then...
Yeah, yeah. And is that the biggest danger, punctures? Is that the biggest time suck?
It's just really hard because it's one of those things where you got to drive really hard, really fast to make up 5 minutes of a flat tire.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that's one of the dangers, yes. So go straight and then see your track. Just crawl up that again. Go play around out there too. Go on that rock, but don't go over the edge.
That one?
Yeah. Just don't go over the edge. There you go. That's it.
Okay, so this stuff is deeply impressive and mildly terrifying, but I think after about 5 or 10 minutes, it also becomes quite unpleasant. So maybe this isn't my favorite section of off-roading and Baja racing.
Well, I know where there's a really cool jump we can go send you off of.
Oh yeah, that sounds much more like it. Okay, so you brought me to a very scary looking jump.
Well, it's only scary because it's the first time. Remember, it only hurts the first time. So let's just work up to it, you know, just give it a moderate run and see what we think. We flip around right here.
Yeah.
So usually when we're coming up here, we're coming pretty fast through here, 60-ish miles an hour, and we don't want to brake too hard, so we brake kind of at the top of the hill.
Okay.
Roll through the hill, and then as we go up the jump up the other side, we kind of get lined up and adjust and judge your speed, and then just give it a little blip right off the lip, and you'll be fine.
Okay, let's see what happens.
It's good. It's good. Center it. Flip it.
Yes! That is so much fun. That doesn't hurt at all. Like, it just soaks it up so easily. So, hell of a day. Felt like we've experienced pretty much everything in this Bronco DR, and I have to say the thing that blows my mind the most is the sheer concentration that you need, because you just can't read the terrain all the time. Wayne, doing it for a few hours, I'm knackered. Tell me about what it's like doing it in a race for like 8 hours straight.
So there's two jobs, you know. If you're a co-driver, it's physically harder because you're just reactive. You just can't. You don't know everything a driver's going to do, and you're just along for the ride. As a driver, it's significantly more mentally challenging. As far as physically, you kind of anticipate what's coming on, you're proactive, you're not really reactive. But the hard thing as a driver is exactly that. You need to have pre-run well and know the terrain, learn how to read the terrain, how it's changing. You know, there's a saying in desert racing that every 100th bump is trying to kill you, and it's your job to recognize that 100th bump. And that's the difficulty is, you know, those, you could have three of those bumps in a row, and if you're not, if you don't have the truck hauled down and you're going too fast, you may end up your day right there. So mentally as a driver, it is physically challenging, but significantly more mentally challenging.
Well, you say that, but I've been doing this a few hours and I'm absolutely shattered. So I am ready for a hot bath. Thank you for an amazing day.
Well, wait a minute. Before you get in your hot bath, we have one more thing we haven't done yet.
Okay.
What do you think about a silt shower?
Do we have to?
Yeah, let her eat.
Okay.
Silt beds are dream destroyers and car killers. Once cut up, they're so soft that they sap power and momentum, and if you slow too much, you end up surfing on the belly of the truck and ultimately getting stuck as the wheels dig you deeper and deeper. So whereas so much of what I've learned today has been about patience rather than abandon, in the silt you just need to keep moving, which means giving the Coyote 5-litre V8 everything it's got.
There it is. This is silt right here.
Oh yeah.
This is turning into silt.
Yeah, you can feel it bashing along the bottom.
So last year, last time we drove this thing, this was so soft, I was having to do 65 miles an hour to get through it.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Today has given a little taste of the physicality of racing the Baja and a brilliant insight into the capabilities of the Bronco DR. It is a fantastic thing that can take staggering punishment in its stride. The DSSV dampers might not offer trophy truck levels of witchcraft, but are pretty magical all the same. To think it has a standard engine, standard automatic gearbox, and so many production spec components, it's pretty amazing. The real insight came from Wayne though. What a legend. Reading the terrain is everything, and he'd spot that killer 100th bump he'd talked about earlier every single time. Without him, I'd have wrapped the DR up in a ball. So that's the Bronco DR, a hell of an experience, and a vehicle which makes all the world a stage. Literally.
Be honest, what was actually more fun, the Bronco DR or the F-150 Raptor?
The DR was more fun because it's more capable. You can go faster. Having a co-driver there is awesome. Him shouting, "Let it eat," or whatever
it
was. It was brilliant. I loved it. And it was a little window into that Baja world, which was great. But the Raptor is so close. It doesn't feel like a pale imitation of what you can actually get. It's a real thing. It's like GT3 RS to cup car. You know, it's that close in
more
ability.
Power,
way more.
More exotic engine. And you can drive it on the freeway when it's time to go home.
I love it.
Well, that's probably enough trucking about for one day. Let's just tell you what's coming up in the next episode, where I'm going to be driving an off-road buggy version of a Singer that's worth several times more than my house.
And I'm going to be wondering why America gets all the manual gearboxes these days.
It's just unfair, isn't it?
Tragic.
If you like car journalists having a rant, you're going to love this film. Thanks for watching. See you on the next one.
Let it eat!